You've asked for it, and now it's here. We're going to deal with the things that matter the most to you.
We're going to go beyond the walls of the church. Things that affect you, affect your children.
Uncut, unscripted. No church, no fluff, no religious stuff.
Greetings, greetings, greetings. Well, I am excited to come into your home today on your smart device, on your smartphone or your tablet or your PC, whichever way you're viewing this broadcast today. Thank you for allowing William Nolan Ministries to connect with you. I want to talk about or start a series today entitled Sustainable Prosperity. Sustainable prosperity. Everyone talks about prosperity. We got prosperity preachers, prosperity books, and all this talk about prosperity. But what is prosperity? How do we define it? The reference key base scripture would be one that's very familiar with to most of us, and that's 3 John 2, which says, "Beloved, above all things, I wish that you may prosper and be in health, comma, even as your soul prospers." So that would be our reference scripture in this 3-part series going forward as we talk about prosperity. So let's look at the word prosperity and let's see how it is defined. It is defined according to most dictionaries or Webster dictionaries. It says a successful, flourishing, or thriving condition, especially in financial respects, comma, or good fortune. So prosperity is used oftentimes as it relates to a monetary affiliation. There is some association of it, some calling it some sense of good fortune or good luck, which means it's something that random may happen to you, may not. There is nothing that you could do to create it. There's nothing that you could do to earn it. So that's something that you may or may not be fortunate enough to experience. So, but it's typically associated with the financial aspect of one's life. The writer says, "I wish above all things that you may prosper and be in health." The condition is, or the association is, even as or equal to your soul prospering. So let's look at soul prosperity. And what does the soul prospering mean? The word soul is a Hebrew word for nephesh. The nephesh is comprised of, our soul rather, is comprised of 3 compartments: the mind, the will, and the emotions. Our mind, how we think; our will, which is our desire, our drive; and number 3, our emotions. How do we feel about different things and different things? On this particular broadcast, we're going to talk about the first part of our soul, our soul prospering, and that is our mind. How do we have the mindset of a prosperous person? 5 points I'm going to give for a prosperous mind. Number 1, recognize the only difference between you and others who have prospered or are prospering, financially speaking, is one thing and one thing only: the way they think. You see, beloved of God, there's no person who is prosperous from a financial perspective that has anything physically different about them, their anatomy, than yours. They still go to sleep at night and get up in the morning. They still eat food. They still go to the restroom. They are still breathing, active human beings, no different than you and I. The only thing that is different, which is cannot be seen, which is intangible, which is invisible, it is the way they process things, the way they think, how they view life, their perspective. Those who are extremely wealthy have 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, 168 hours a week is what that comes down to, the exact same amount of time. So everyone's busy. And if you have nothing to do, then guess what? If I ask you if you had any time, you would still tell me that you were really busy. So everybody is busy, but busyness is not what creates prosperity. It is productivity. And the productivity is tied to how that person thinks in how a person thinks who is not prospering financially. Number two, beware of systems and groups and affiliations that make you think that you are a victim. I'm going to say that again. To obtain a prosperous mindset, you must beware of systems, groups, and affiliations that require you to believe that you are a victim. See, as long as you think that you are a victim, then you put yourself in the position of being oppressed. You see, I'm always leery of groups types of groups or different affiliations that have to appeal to me, and they cater towards the area they say within my life that is an area that's been oppressed, and they are the one to rescue me out of it, that I must have their help in order to overcome. To have the mindset of one who is prosperous, you must believe beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are not a victim. You must believe that you are a victor. You must believe without a shadow of a doubt that you don't, that your success is not constrained or limited because another individual or a group or an institution or a system has restrained you. So as long as you think and that there is a system or a group or an individual that can control or constrain you, you have declared that you have no ability to change that, because your success is tied to someone else's ability to set you free or willingness to let you into the group. Number three, those who have a mindset, a prosperous mindset, develop strength under stress. You see, stress is a weight. Stress is pressure. And in order to develop a prosperous mindset, you must be able to separate yourself from stressful situations and circumstances. You see, all of us deal with stress. Stress is a part of life. Whether you're the multimillionaire or whether you are the individual who is in need, all of us experience stress. We all have opportunities for health challenges and family challenges and issues that relate to conflict, stress. Stress comes in all shapes, forms, and sizes. The more money you make, the more opportunities that you have for stress. Everything has stress. Stress is there for the millionaire. Stress is there for the beggar. Stress is there for the mother. Stress is there for the teenager. Everyone in life experiences stress from one sense or another. But those who develop a prosperous mindset know and learn over time how to divorce themselves from the stressful situation in order to properly think and exercise their cognitive abilities to make crucial decisions in the midst of stress. You see, when we make decisions under stress, and the stress becomes the factor that drives a decision, oftentimes we make the wrong decision. You see, those who make more clearer decisions in the midst of the same amount of stress learns to look at the situation from a long-term perspective, and in spite of what they're feeling in the midst of stress, their decision making is still based upon a set of principles that guide their life and a long-term goal that's been already predetermined and pre-established. Fourth point of mental prosperity: learning how to detox mentally. Have you ever did a detox? How many of y'all ever done a detox? You ever decided you were just going to cleanse, you were going to stay away from certain types of food, whether it be meats or white powder or sugars and things of that nature, and you were going to do a cleanse. You're going to take some time. Why do we take the time to detox our physical body, to flush out all of the toxins and all the waste that builds up over time from our improper eating habits or the types of things that we eat that have a tendency to stay within our digestive system that can create problems over time, but we never take the time to detox mentally. You see, all of us has experienced some form of, and I can say this right, crap. We all experience crap. crap in life, the things that we had no control over. Some of us grew up and we seen things that we shouldn't have saw. There were tremendous things that were done in our life that was unwarranted. Some of us grew up seeing being abused, seeing abuse. Some of us grew up in homes where there was drug use. Some of us grew up around different circumstances and situations that were unconducive for young children. And then we went to high school and school, and we got picked on and bullied, and we saw things and experienced things that all provoked us to have a negative self-image. All of us have experienced different things in life that we have seen from one aspect to another that has allowed crap into our mind. But if you are going to succeed mentally, you have to decide that you must do a detox. How do we do a detox mentally? Number one, we can't change what was already put in. So what we do is we want to overcome or oversaturate what was already previously there. You see, if all we ever heard were words of condemnation, words of demotivation, and words that you can't do and what you're not going to be, then guess what? We need at least 2 to 3 times amount more of that into our mental psyche so that we can begin to believe that we are somebody. We can do something. I'm more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. We have got to hear those things 3 times the amount as much as we did the first time. Detox. We have got to separate ourselves mentally. Listen, if you're going to change your life, you change your thinking, and if your thinking is the same way that it has been, then your results in life are going to be the same. See, we can no longer afford to put things into our mind that are toxic. Some of the things that we like to watch are toxic. They're appealing to our sensual side. But some talk shows and some things that we watch that are all conflict and fighting and gossip behaviors and all this just gossip lifestyles and just celebrity trash talking, all of that is toxic to your mind. Successful people learn how to put successful things into their mind. You ever heard of what they call GIGO? Garbage in, garbage out. So that's what comes out because of what has been going in. But beloved, I want to call it PIPO, prosperity in and prosperity out. Change what you put into your mind on a daily basis. Last point, and the fifth part is, you must have an optimistic look at life. As I said earlier, we all experience different areas of stress in our life, and we will continue to experience stress until we're 6 feet deep covered with worms. We will all experience stress. A lot of us have experienced all types of negative things that have happened to us or around us. All those things have happened to some of us more or less than. But you must have an optimistic view of life. If life circumstances and situations has caused you to always see the glass half empty, then your glass all of your life will always be half empty. Your glass will never be half full until you change your perspective and you actually see it as half full. Because for the one who sees it as half empty, has said to themselves and to the world that this is reality. This is my reality. The reality of the fact, it is half empty. The reality of the fact is I'm broke. The reality of the fact is my credit is jacked up. The reality of the fact is that I've been divorced 7 times. That's the reality of it. But guess what? The reality of it is that glass is actually half full. The reality of it is that I don't have any money, but I'm abundant in ideas and concepts in my mind that are going to bring me money. You are only as broke as you think. You're only as poor as your perspective is in life. So that's the reality. Which reality do you choose to believe? Which one? You see, we must have an optimistic perspective in life. And optimism must be the glasses from which we see the world. That's what optimism is, folks. Optimism, you ever heard the word optics? Ophthalmologist? That's how we see. That's where the root word comes from. So to see things in a better perspective, we must wear the lenses or the glasses of optimism. Change your prescription to optimism versus pessimism. And whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. And whatsoever a man sees, that's what he will bring into reality. That's not the book. That's William Nolan Ministries. So those are the five. You must recognize the difference between how you think and how those who are prosperous think, and align your thinking with those who have a prosperity mentality. You must beware of those systems and those groups and affiliations that cause you to think that you are a victim, and you cannot overcome unless you go through them or to them in order to overcome. You must be able to develop strength under stress. You must be able to separate yourself from that which you're going through and to remain consistent and persistent towards the goals in which you have already outset for yourself. Thank you for tuning in to this series for part one of Creating Sustainable Prosperity. I'm looking forward to the next one when we talk about prosperity as it relates to our will. That one's going to be very interesting, very powerful. Stay tuned in. Continue to follow us on Twitter at Nolan Ministries. Hit the like button, subscribe to this channel, and we'll see you in our next broadcast. God bless you.
Thank you for watching William Nolan Ministries. We hope you have enjoyed our channel. If today's message has been a blessing to you, please hit that like button and subscribe to our channel. Thank you and have a wonderful day.